you join me in our call to worship. Come, all you people, come from east and west, north and south.
Let the distant shores rejoice.
The whole creation declares your glory, Lord. A symphony of sound and colors around us. If we will for a moment stand with eyes and ears attuned, the Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. Offer your prayers to God, and also, you know, this is a very important week in the life of our country and in the life of the world. So as you offer your prayer, let us pray for God's leadership as our nation, our state, and our county votes for the leadership who will lead us in the coming years. Will you join me as we pray? Mighty God, we bless you for the joy of worship. It is here in this space, this sanctuary, that we remember you are the God who loves us, the God who cares for us, and the God who has come to us in that perfect human being, Christ Jesus, the Lord, who pleased not himself, but pleased you and was the expiation for our sins and the sins of the world. And out of that true obedience, you have raised him in power and in triumph and in glory. Now he is our perfect intercessor. We think about the gifts of life. We think about life itself, how you breathe the breath of life into our very being. You set before us the ways of life and death. You set us in this beautiful world of creation, this planet spinning in the silent sea of space. What a beautiful world you have given. Each day as we live, give us an awareness that it is all your creation and that it is indeed a gift. For us this day are the sacred elements of bread and wine, holy, sacred memorials of your love for us, the broken body and the shed blood of your Son who gave himself. As we share this table hosted by Christ himself, may his Spirit be among us to give us strength for life, encouragement for difficult times, and a sense of wholeness in our life as we look forward to every tomorrow with hope, promise, and joy. Hear us as we offer these and all of our prayers in your Son's name. We pray. Amen. Now I'd like to call on Pam to our church moderator to come and bring us some words of welcome and share some opportunities, some very important opportunities for our ministry.
Good morning. What a beautiful morning. Right, the humidity has left us, and for those of us with lots of hair, we are so grateful for that. I know, Roman, I know, and I share that. First of all, it is my privilege to welcome first-time visitors to our church. So do we have any first-time visitors? Well, please stand. Please stand. We thank you so much for finding us this morning. Appreciation for finding us this morning. And in that special gift bag, you'll find a cup, a mug, and on that mug, there'll be a picture of the Mayflower where we trace our roots. So thank you so much. And we have a new visitor I met earlier this morning. Welcome. And where are you from? From Naples. Terrific. And you too have a gift and a mug to remember us by. So thank you. Do you have anyone else? Over here, this gentleman. That's okay, and where are you from?
Here in
Naples. Terrific. And did you get your gift back? All right. Thank you so much. I just want to say a few words about the contemporary service held last night. I've learned so much. I mean, I learned that even if you have a terrible voice, and those of you who are sitting around me know this, you can still praise God with song. It was unbelievable. And I also learned that there are several people in the church that have a beautiful voice and are not members of the choir. Roland, for example, was behind me, and you led the men's half of several of those songs. I heard that. And I also know that Doris and Daisy, absolute gorgeous voices.
If you put any more responsibility on
there, I will never see you. As long as he sits behind me, temporary service. And what I also learned is to be a great, great minister, such as Pastor Les. You do not have to have the talent to be able to clap the rhythm of the music. It was quite a show. Anyhow, it was an absolutely wonderful, wonderful service, and I do encourage you, 5:30 on Saturday, to join us, and most importantly, bring some of your friends. The flowers this morning were given by Frank, in honor of his mother. So if any of you would like to donate flowers, there's a sign-up sheet right outside the door. I have several announcements that I want to bring your attention to. They are on page 4. But at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning is the men's breakfast. So please join the men. And then that evening at 6 p.m., the women's group will be packing up patriotic tips. But I know it would be okay to have a few men come to join you, correct? We are a very open organization, yes. Financial peace is on Thursday at 6:30 along with the trustees meeting. I also want to announce the seminar that Barbara will be conducting next Saturday. Is that correct? So please read about it. If you're interested, please sign up. A few announcements. I do have Diane and Stacy who would like to make an announcement. Would you like to come up? Stacy, are you coming down? Oh, she's already down. And maybe you'd like to help us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that was a weak good morning.
Good morning.
You know, we're so excited, aren't we, Stacy, to get up here and show you some things that you can take home with you. You know, I'm doing a business retreat this weekend that I couldn't be at, and the women there are just being blessed. They're laughing, they're playing games, they have lots of food, they're building new relationships that will forever be in their heart and mind. Now, we're gonna have one on December 2nd and 3rd. And we want you. Now, someone, Stacy, I'm going to let you tell about this handbag. I'll hold it and you talk.
Well, this handbag, oh, I sound like I'm very loud, I'm sorry. This handbag, we have a raffle for some of our ladies who bring the most guests. And if you bring at least 3 minimum, you have a chance to win this bag. This bag is, I think, retail of $250.
That's good.
Can you see it? $248. And all you have to do is bring 3 friends if you have a chance to win it. There's also other raffles that we have. If you have... Oh, I brought the microphone.
Thank you for that. I plan to be there as well, of course. Roland, do you have something, some announcement for our church?
Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
This is the time of year that you usually see me up here with a challenge. And I want to go back a little bit. How many folks are here from the beginning? This started in what our congregation knows as a house about 12 or 13 years ago with maybe 10 or 12 people. This church started. That's how far we went. How many folks are here that attended this church when it was in the school cafeteria? I'd like you to stand. Please stand.
Hear these words. For it will be as for a man going on a journey, called his servants, and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to 2, to another 2, and to another, each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded them, and he made 5 more. So also he who had 2 talents made 2 more. But he who received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled the accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents, here I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also, the man 2 talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here I've made 2 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. He also who received the 1 talent came forward, saying, Master, I knew you would be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not winnow. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But the master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not withered. And you ought to have invested my money in good bankers. Then by coming, I should have received what was mine with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will more be given, and he who has abundance from him who was not, has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servants into the outer darkness. There men will weep and gnash their teeth. And may the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word. Well, you know the saying, my friends, it takes a village to raise a child. It takes a church. It takes people to run a church. It takes a lot of talent, a lot of cooperation, a lot of dedication and commitment. It's not just about people, you see. It's about the gifts that people have. And every church, every organization is endowed with people who have numerous, numerous gifts. Everyone in any particular church has something to give, a particular gift, a particular talent that he or she can offer to God's service through the church. We might ask a question this morning in reference to talents and using our gifts to the glory of God. What if everyone in the church were just like me in the church and move forward? Let it be an exciting and inspiring congregation. You see, there was a man from New York who had a dream. He dreamed day after day, month after month, of owning a cattle ranch. And he saved his money, until he finally had enough money to buy the ranch. And he sold his property in New York and moved to Texas. He was telling his friend about his new ranch, how proud he was of his ranch. His friend once said, Well, you know, ranches always have names. What is the name of your ranch? And he said, Well, my wife and I couldn't really settle on a name. We went back and forth, trying to discern what the right name for the ranch should be. So here's the name we settled on. The Double R Lazy L, Triple Horseshoe Bar, Hyphen, 7 Lucky Diamond Ranch. Friends, that's a lot of cows. Well, we once had a lot of cows, he said, but none of them survived the branding. Sometimes we get so caught up in what our role might be, how we're going to serve the church, we don't survive the servanthood. What it is that we're about in terms of serving the church, sharing our gifts, whatever our gifts may be. The lesson from Matthew this morning, Jesus is talking about separating the sheep from the goats. Sandwiched between those 2 parables is this parable, one of the great parables of Jesus, parable of talents. It's a powerful passage about what God has given. And of course, a talent was, in fact, a sum of money. But the application is not only be about investing one's money and resources, but investing one's talent, what gift or gifts a person has been given. And certainly, we've not all been given the same gifts. As Pam said this morning, some of us can't keep time in the river. It's not a gift. Some people have, and others can just keep time in perfect order with the rhythm of music. It's a particular gift some people have, and unfortunately, Pam, some of us do not have. So, what do we learn from this passage? The first thing we learn is what we have is not ours. That's an important concept of the Bible, particularly the New Testament. What we have is not ours. Now, the wealthy man was going on a journey, and of course, the parable here is that the wealthy man is, in fact, God himself. He entrusted his property to his servants, delegating responsibilities to various servants who had various abilities. When he returned, he would see what they had done with what he had given them. With his property, but listen, the property still belonged to the master. The master did not give away his property, he only gave away the talents. We might say that the servants are our managers. Financial managers of what the master had given. So the message is, what we have is not ours. Now, we may think everything we have is ours. After all, the mortgage is paid off, or we're paying on the mortgage, the title is in our name. We own the car, we own the furniture, we own everything, the land. Not so, according to the Bible. We're just borrowing. We're just living in the house for a period of time. We're living on the earth for a period of time, as we're told in the book of Psalms, Psalm 24, verse 1. Listen, the earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world, and all who live in it, are God's. The basic principle of life is that we don't really own anything. It all belongs to God. Second thing we learned from this parable, this important parable, what we are given what we can handle. We're given what we can handle. Now, if we can't do the rhythm, we're not given that talent. We're only given what we can handle. To one, he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. And of course, a talent is a piece of money. But the parable is applicable also to talents. What do we think of as talents? And the very first time I heard this story of the talents was I was about 5th grade in school. And back then, a local pastor who happened to be a friend of our family came to the school and gave a devotional. Now, you know, unfortunately, you can't do that in schools today, but he talked about, this was the beginning of school, and he talked about talents, using our talents, and I remember to this day what Reverend Vestal told us as boys and girls, to apply our talents, to apply our gifts. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, now there are a variety of gifts, but it is the same Spirit. When we look across this room, we see there are a variety of gifts. Many people in this room can do various kinds of things, various gifts, skills, abilities, but it is the same Spirit and the same God whom we serve. There was once two men who crashed a plane on an island. It was an uninhabited island, a small island, way, way, way out in the sea. And the first man was so distraught, they crawled out of the plane, came up on the beach, and they were there just panting for life and breath. And after several days passed, the first man was distressed and without words. He couldn't even talk. He finally got the words out, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? No one will ever come to rescue us. The second gentleman was quite calm, in fact. He said, don't worry. Help's on the way. He says, I'm a wealthy man. I make $200,000 a year. And I tithe to the church. My pastor will find where we are. Now, we're not talking about money this morning. We're talking about put you at ease. Back to the story. What a tremendous difference between the 5 talents, the 10 talents, and the 1 talent. But each was given according to his ability. Your responsibility is tied to your ability. What ability the Lord feels you have. Everybody has a different talent, some are giving more. Some can sing, some can teach, some have leadership, some can give financial support. It is all a part of our talent. Whatever it is you can do, it is a gift from God. Whatever gift you may have, give that gift to God's service. We read in 1 Corinthians, there are a variety of gifts, but the Holy Spirit distributes them as the Spirit has determined. So it is in the mind and in the purview of God to distribute the gifts to whomever God pleases. God entrusts different gifts to different people. Our job, according to this parable, and I think the parable says it quite plainly, our job is to be faithful with whatever gift we're given. Whatever it is, be faithful with that gift. And the truth is, that gift will be multiplied. It will come back again and again. Thirdly, we learned that we must invest what has been given. Well, we read in verse 16, the man who received 5 talents went at once, put himself to work, and then earned 5 more. So it was with the man who went with 2 talents. The man who only had was given 1 talent. I'm sorry for himself. I'm not blessed. I wasn't treated fairly. I don't have the same as these other 2 men. So he went and buried his talent. He was sorry for himself. You know, there's a saying, and I believe this is true about life. Use it or blow. Lose it. It's true. You have a talent, whatever it is, you have a skill, you've been endowed with a particular gift. Use it or lose it. It's simply that simple. It will go away. Antonio's voice was high and squeaky, so he did not make tryouts for the Cremona Boys Choir. And how Antonio wouldn't be a part of the choir, he just dreamed and dreamed and dreamed about singing and being a part of the boys choir. But the tryouts, his little squeaky voice was just too much for the director, and he was cut. He was quite sad. But his parents wanted to make Antonio happy, so they decided to give him violin lessons. If he couldn't sing, perhaps he could learn to play the violin. But the friends of his parents said, it's a waste of time. It's a waste of money. Antonio just doesn't have what it takes. Why waste so much? Prince gave Antonio a hard time, but it was discovered that he had 1 talent. He was quite good at whittling, working with wood. When he was a little older, he served as an apprentice with wood, whittling, making things. In fact, he was a violin maker, an apprentice as a violin maker. His knack grew from whittling to the skill of carving, and his hobby became his craft. By the time he had died, he had made over 1,500 violins, each with his name, Antonio Stradivarius. The most sought-after violins in the world. The last record in U.S. dollars, $3,544,000, which is what the violin, the Stradivarius, was sold for. That was in 2007. Zig Ziglar said, you are the only person on earth who has your ability. Think about that. The only person on earth who can do what you can do. More than we learn from this parable, there's a day of accountability. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and was there to say, it counts with them. The implication is simple. There comes a time when you and I stand before God, and God will say to us, what have you done with what I gave you? Your gift, your talent, your resource. Did you sing or teach or serve? More importantly, how we access our lives. Do we hoard the talents to ourselves, or do we share them generously? Or do we leave it to somebody else? You know, that I want sometimes to be Mr. Somebody Else. If you ever meet Mr. Somebody Else, please introduce me to that person, because I know it to be. Because sometimes we always leave it to somebody else, and there's an old saying, a proverb. If it's going to be, it's up to me. Think about applying that to your life and my life. If something's going to happen, there's no somebody else. It's you, it's me. Eric Erickson, one of the famed psychiatrists, wrote the book, Eight Stages of Man, which he divided life into eight stages. The earliest stage is trust versus mistrust. When a baby learns to either trust the world or the world is not trustworthy. But the final stage is the stage that we all come to, we live long enough, is integrity versus despair. Integrity means when a person reaches a certain age, that person looks back over his or her life and says, I did a good job, I did well with what I was given. I'm proud, feel a sense of satisfaction and joy. Or despair, meaning, you know, I was given a lot, and I really didn't use it very well. My life doesn't have the meaning that it could have been. In the words of the Bible, in the words of this parable, you know those words. Words of the master. Words that we will hear from God if we use our gifts. What are those words? Well done. Well done. Good and faithful servant. There was a world famous Polish piano maestro who was giving a concert in New York City, one of the great, great city music halls. His name was Ignaz Paderewski. You recognize that name, of course, one of the great pianists. Oh, it was such a formal evening as people gathered, ladies in long gowns, men in tuxedos, white bow ties. It was spiffy beyond words. Everyone was just waiting. Paderewski to come on stage and perform like a performance they had never seen. Well, just prior to the concert, a mother had devoured a little boy, thinking, well, if he hears Paderewski, it will inspire him. And he too will become a great pianist. He will follow his gift. He will follow his talent. Well, she turned to a neighbor. They were talking about the upcoming concert. And unbeknownst to her, the little boy slipped away. Down the aisle, walked down the aisle, went up on the stage, and sat down at the grand piano and chopsticks. And people were a bit disgusted. We didn't come here to hear chopsticks. Whose child is that? What is he doing on the stage? And all of those kind of snide, little nasty remarks for the sophisticated people. Guess what? From off stage, Paderewski saw what was happening. So, he walks out on the stage, embraces the little boy, puts his arms around him, and starts playing the chopsticks. The accompaniment to the chopsticks. It was a sound like that audience had never heard before. What an inspiration. And he kept whispering in the little boy's ear, keep going, son. Keep going, son. The little boy continued to pray. And when they finished playing chopsticks, there was a standing ovation that seemed to never, never stop. Such was the sound of chopsticks. chopsticks. I'm going to tell you this morning, when you use your talent, your gift, whatever you've been given, whatever talent, whatever skill, whatever resources you have, God puts his arms around you and whispers in your ear, keep going, son. Keep going, daughter. And the music that's playing is joy to the ears of the angels of heaven. Use it or lose it. Let us respond to the gifts of God, the generosity of God, and the giving and receiving of the offering.
Thank you.
invite all to the Lord's table, for we believe that the Lord is the host of this table. If you're here as a visitor, a friend of the church, we certainly invite you to participate in the sacrament of the Lord. Let us hear the words of invitation. Even if truly Mary said, repent of your sins, and our love and charity with your neighbor intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in God's holy ways, draw near by faith. Take this holy sacrament to your comfort as you make your humble confession to Almighty God. We receive the words of institution of the Lord's Supper from the Apostle Paul in his letter to the church at Corinth, when he said, "For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, This is my body which is broken for you. In the same way, after the Lord's Supper, he took the cup and he said, This is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Drink ye all of it in remembrance of me." In that same passage, the Apostle Paul reminded the church, as we are reminded, that as we approach the table of the Lord, we are to examine our lives. Will you therefore join me in a prayer of confession and repentance? My God, we do not presume to come to this your table, trusting in our own goodness or righteousness, but in yours, and in that of your Son, who was without sin and yet was obedient to your purposes, even to his death on the cross, and out of that sacrificial death, you raised him in power and in glory, and he is now our intercessor. We confess our sins before you. Have mercy upon us. Blot out all our sins and transgressions, which we confess. Amen. My friends, hear the promises of the gospel, the words of our Lord. He that comes unto me, I will in no wise cast out. The gifts of God for the people of God come for all things are ready. body of Christ broken for you, take and eat. Amen. Can you join me in a prayer of thanksgiving? Mighty God, we bless you that you have refreshed us here at your table by granting us these sacred substances of bread and wine. May they become in us living memorials. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of Christ.